Good morning and welcome to Park Church's online service. Next week is an exciting week for us because we'll be here online and we'll also be in the sanctuary. So you could pick either form of worshiping next week. If you plan to come to the sanctuary to worship with us, please plan to follow the social distancing guidelines. There will not be a coffee hour or social gatherings before the worship service, but you're more than welcome to join us for the service itself in the sanctuary next week. Next week also, we will have the blessing of the animals at 1 p.m. in Central Park. This is an event for everyone in the community, not just Park Church members. So if your neighbors have pets that they would like to bring, please invite them to come and join in the blessing of the animals. Again, it's October 4th at 1 p.m. in Central Park. There will be a Zoom hour today from 11 to 11:30, so please join us. Please try to join on time because we do wrap up pretty much at 11:30, so please join us for fellowship at 11 a.m. this morning for the coffee hour. That's all of our announcements for this week. Please listen to Creator of the Stars of Night and read through the reflective reading, which is Psalm 78, verses 1 through 4. Please join me in the call to worship. Listen, O people, to holy teaching. Tune your ears to hear God's word. We gather to proclaim our sacred story, to tell of God's wondrous deeds. Come, O people, into holy space to worship the Lord, our sustainer and guide. Let us turn to God in prayer and praise. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for being ever present with us. We know that we are never alone. Your mercies have been faithful and rich. Pour out your Spirit upon us, that we might do the work of your will. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Come, thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. I raise my Ebenezer, here by thy great help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Precious blood. That day when freed from sinning, I shall see thy lovely face. Clothed then in blood-washed linen, how I'll sing thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer tarry, take my ransom soul away. Send thine angels now to carry me to realms of endless day. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I am constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor, trusting in the promise of forgiveness. Please join me in the prayer of confession. Loving Lord, you desire that we have the same mind as Christ and imitate his compassionate service. But our minds are fixed on attitudes and ambitions that draw us away from you. We labor for ourselves and attend to the needs of a precious few before considering how our time and talents could bless the world. We look up to the rich and famous and overlook the lowly rather than affirm the dignity of all. Transform us, we pray, by your grace. Give us the same mind and the same love as our Lord Jesus Christ, and work within us until our actions bear witness to the faith our tongues confess. People of God, our sins are forgiven. The Lord is loving, and we are reconciled to God. Friends, it is through Jesus Christ that we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Without you, I fall apart.
is where you are, and where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. It's where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you.
From Matthew 21, verses 23 through 32. Listen for the word of the Lord. When Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and elders of the people came to him as he was teaching. They asked, "What kind of authority do you have for doing these things? Who gave you this authority?" Jesus replied, "I have a question for you. If you tell me the answer, I'll tell you what kind of authority I have to do these things. Where did John get his authority to baptize? Did he get it from heaven or from humans?" They argued among themselves, "If we say from heaven, he'll say to us, 'Then why didn't you believe him?' But we can't say from humans because we're afraid of the crowd, since everyone thinks John was a prophet." Then they replied, "We don't know." Jesus also said to them, "Neither will I tell you what kind of authority I have to do these things." Parable of two sons. What do you think? A man had two sons. Now he came to the first and said, "Son, go and work in the vineyard today." "No, I don't want to," he replied, but later changed his mind and went. The father said the same thing to the other son, who replied, "Yes, sir," but he did not go. "Which one of these two did his father's will?" They said, "The first one." Jesus said to them, "I assure you that the tax collectors and prostitutes are entering God's kingdom ahead of you. For John came to you on the righteous road, and you didn't believe him. But tax collectors and prostitutes believed him. Yet even after you saw this, you didn't change your hearts and lives, and you didn't believe him." Our second reading this morning comes from Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 13. "Therefore, if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort in love, any sharing in the Spirit, any sympathy, complete my joy by thinking the same way, having the same love, being united and agreeing with each other. Don't do anything for selfish purposes, but with humility, think of others as better than yourselves. Instead of each person watching out for their own good, watch out for what is better for others. Adopt the attitude that was in Christ Jesus. Though he was in the form of God, he did not consider being equal with God something to exploit, but he emptied himself by taking the form of a slave and by becoming like human beings. When he found himself in the form of a human, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God highly honored him and gave him a name above all names, so that the name of Jesus, everyone in heaven, on earth, and under the earth might bow to every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my loved ones, just as you always obey me, not just when I am present, but now even more while I am away, carry out your own salvation with fear and trembling. God is the only one who enables you both to want to actually live out his good purposes." This is the word of the Lord.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, O God, our rock and redeemer. Amen. This past week surely has been a week chock full of many unusual and some surprising happenings. Starting with the death of Ruth Bader Ginsburg, watching the push and rush to fill a Supreme Court seat, and the rumblings about the possible refusal of a peaceful turnover has politically made this week full in the news cycle and filling our heads with a lot of things to think about. As I looked at the preaching text for this week, I really debated between the two texts that we just heard, because both of these texts offer rich opportunities for preaching. So I decided to use both texts. There was one line in our second text that stood out in my mind and continues to stand out in my mind. It's the line that's posted on the screen right now. "God is the one who enables you both to want and to actually live out his good purposes." But what are his good purposes? As I reflected over all the happenings of the past week and considered what would God's one purpose be for us, one word comes to mind: unity. To me, it makes good sense that God would want unity right now. And unity is greatly lacking in the world today, both in the secular world and in the religious world. Unity is lacking in our government, and disunity seems to be spreading at a rapid pace more and more each day. Differences are not being addressed. Neither side seems to be listening to the other. Each side is digging their heels in deeper, moment by moment, leaving those of us on the sideline wondering when it will end, if ever. The unknowns and the unanswered questions leave many of us stressed and worried. What is going to happen to healthcare? What about pre-existing conditions? Will there be Social Security for me when I retire? And the list goes on. And the disunity factor is the same within our religious circles. Christians are on opposite sides of these issues, defending their positions and taking their stances. Each side questions the Christianity of the opposite side. It seems unreal to me. The world, and especially this country, are in great divide, much as it was in our Matthew text this morning. When Jesus' authority was being questioned by the chief priests and elders, Jesus asked them a few simple questions. Where did John get his authority to baptize? And did he get it from heaven or from humans? And as we heard in the story, the chief priests and the elders, they argued about this. And then they tried simple logic. If we say from heaven, he'll say to us, then why didn't you believe him? But we can't say from humans because we're afraid of the crowd, since everyone thinks John was a prophet. And then they took this simple and easy way out, saying, we don't know. Sometimes it's hard to know who to follow. In the case of the chief priests and elders, they were afraid of the crowd, since everyone thought he was a prophet, yet they didn't necessarily agree. Who do we follow in these chaotic and messy times? Is Christ in this mix somewhere? How can we become unified? Disunity comes with disagreement, while unity comes from compromise. Can we as Christians compromise in this day and age? And I caution you to listen very closely to what I'm saying. I am not saying to compromise your beliefs in God or Jesus Christ or in doing Christ's work as his disciples. But what I am saying is sometimes we need to compromise in our actions. We can turn to God in these moments when we feel this strong disunity happening, and instead of lashing out at those who we disagree with, we can listen to God. The lashing out to somebody else really serves no purpose but to maybe make ourselves feel better. We can ask God to show us his mercy. We can be imitators of God rather than imitators of evilness. We can put our hope into God. Hope assures us that God is actively engaged. Some days I fear for where we're heading as a nation, as a community, and sometimes even a faith community, because we lack the ability to be tolerant of each other. This past week, I made a post on social media, and I asked the question, I wonder how the president felt when the crowds were chanting to vote him out. I wasn't asking for a response on how people felt about our president, but that's where they went. I was asking, I wonder how our president felt. My thoughts were, did he feel proud? Was he saddened? Did he even hear them? And if he did, would he change his current ways? And I was shocked by the responses to my post. Many different viewpoints were presented in the first few minutes that it was posted. My post quickly became a battleground for people calling people names and obscenities from both sides being spewed at each other, and people private messaging me so I would take their side or defend mine on my post. That's not what this post was about or what it was intended to be. I truly felt compassion for the president because, after all, he is a person. And I also felt that same level of compassion for the people who were chanting to vote him out. I truly wondered if people could see both sides and what each side was thinking. Could they relate to each other? I didn't expect that people would begin attacking each other on my feed. It doesn't matter which side you're on in this political fight. We must remember that all the players in this political arena are people, and there are ways to handle our differences of opinion in Christ-like ways. We don't have to stoop to a lower level. I ended up pulling the post, but it made me stop and think. Here are my friends, my Christian friends, acting out in ways that seemed so unChrist-like. It was very disappointing to see the name-calling and the comments that they made. Most of the comments were non-productive, coming across as hate statements, which really didn't help the situation. I think, and I wonder what the picture will look like when the November election results come in. One side will win and another will lose. And in so many ways, we all lose if the politicalness of all this continues to clutter our minds and our actions. Finding unity in this chaos is hard, and it's even going to be harder to restore once we get past the elections if we continue down this road. How can we, as faithful Christians, be thoughtful to one another when our views are so very different? How can we set our judgments aside about each other? How can we become loving Christians again to the people who we claim to hate now for their political beliefs? How can we reach out to those people again? This is where our lesson from Philippians comes into play. Paul wrote this letter while he was in prison for speaking of the gospel and Christ. Part of his letter is joyful, while other parts of his letter are, as the Harper Study Bible calls them, a subsidiary theme of his disappointment and worry. Paul is disappointed in the dissension within the community. He actually calls out those who dissent from his point of view. He calls them dogs and evildoers and enemies of the cross. And this is quite a stance for Paul to take. But yet he also calls for the Christians of that day to maintain unity and to stand firm in the Lord. Paul calls for the Christians to whom he writes to share in his joy by thinking the same way, by having the same love, by being united, and by agreeing with each other. And sometimes to agree with others means that you're going to agree to disagree, but treat each other well. He tells them, don't do anything for selfish purposes, but do things with humility and think of others as better than yourselves. Instead of each person watching out for their own good, he says to watch out for what is better for others. Adopt the attitude that was in Jesus Christ. What do you think the attitude of Jesus Christ would be today? Would he be marching for the rights of the oppressed and the poor and the marginalized? Would he be standing up for health care and for equal rights? Would he be standing up to bridge the gap between the rich and the poor? Would he be calling out his basic command to love your neighbor as yourself? And how do your views line up with these issues today? Do they line up with Christ's views? Can we look beyond our own needs, wants, and desires to put somebody else first? How can we as Christians unite ourselves back together again in Christ's love and move forward in spite of our differences? It will take some time. It will take some mercy. We will need to forgive each other. We can and we will walk together in Christ's love by showing Christ's love in our actions and in our words. The Bible says many things about love, and here are just a few examples. You can follow along on the screen if you'd like. Love is patient. Love is kind. Do everything in love. Owe no one anything except to love each other, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. Therefore, what God has joined together, no one will separate. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devout to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on a tablet of your heart. Hatred stirs up conflict, but love covers all the wrongs. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. And finally, John in chapter 15, 12 said, my command is this, love each other as I have loved you. So let me ask you, which of these verses speaks to you? Which of these verses speaks to your heart and attaches itself to your heart that you can give back? Can you commit to love your neighbor as you love yourself? Paul said, God is the one who enables you both to want and to actually live out his good purposes. Can you live into this call and into God's purpose? Amen.
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that our unity may one day be restored. And then know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yeah, by our love. We were we will work side by side and we'll guard each man's dignity and see each man's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yeah, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Our prayers of the people this morning are call and response. I will say, Lord, in your mercy, and the response is, hear our prayers. I'd ask that you please type your prayers of joys and concerns and thanksgiving into the screen so we can all hold them up in prayer. Let us pray for the needs of the world, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O God, who is ever present, you hear our cries and are faithful in your mercy. We come to you with our concerns for ourselves, our community, and the world. For our church and its leaders, fill them with the spirit and mind of Christ so that they would serve you and others. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our country and the global community. Enable our leaders to make decisions for the sake of people and not profits, to serve others and not themselves. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for our local community. We pray for teachers and educators, that they may remain safe as they continue to do their work in this time during COVID. We pray for the students and the parents and the hospital workers and the caregivers, that they all remain in good health. We pray for those affected by COVID in any way. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who suffer with sickness, with sadness, bereavement, anxiety, or abuse. Envelop them in your love and help us to be their community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for other intentions that we know we're holding close to our hearts. We pray for Kay and Dale Gruber and their family as they mourn the loss of Kay's sister. We continue to pray for Thurlow Hammond as he recovers from his surgery. And we also continue to pray for Sue Bowens and her family, that they may find peace in these days to come after the loss of Sue's husband, Jake. We pray for all those who suffer, and all the prayer intentions that we give over to you today, O God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, we know that you walk with us and you answer when we call. With gratitude and trust, we pray in Jesus' name, as we pray now the prayer that Jesus taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The works of the Lord are wondrous indeed. Let us offer back to God a portion of what has been given to us for the glory of God's name. You can send your pledge into the church office via mail or bring it with you even next week to keep the pledges moving along. And now, friends, let this mind be in you that was also in Christ. Love the Lord and serve others for the glory of God. May the God who is always near bless us and keep us on our journeys. Glory, honor, and praise be to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and always. Amen.